A nombre del Colegio Nacional y en particular a nombre del doctor Sarukán y del mío propio, les queremos dar la bienvenida a esta última sesión de los Viernes de Evolución, que es una sesión extraordinaria porque, como ustedes saben, hemos estado terminando estos seminarios en los el segundo viernes de noviembre, de cada mes de noviembre. Y en esta ocasión se puede decir que es un seminario extraordinario, no solo porque decidimos irnos hacia diciembre, es una buena manera de comenzar las posadas, sino también porque tenemos a dos conferencistas absolutamente extraordinarios, que son los doctores Rosemary Grant y Peter Grant. Son amigos personales muy queridos, los conozco desde hace muchos años y los admiro probablemente desde muchos años más. Pocas personas conocen mejor la fauna, en particular la avifauna de las Islas Galápagos, que ellos. Se puede decir con toda justeza que son los herederos naturales del estudio de los pinzones que Charles Darwin describió mal en las Galápagos, pero ellos han usado precisamente el modelo de las islas y en particular de la población de las aves de las islas para estudiar los procesos de especiación. Y al hacerlo lo han hecho de una forma que yo encuentro que de verdad es una lección que todos los naturalistas, todos los biólogos, todos los científicos, estudiantes, profesores de ciencias de la vida tenemos que tomar en cuenta. Conocen de una manera absolutamente extraordinaria la biología natural de los organismos. Conocen muy bien las especies, los fenotipos, conocen los hábitos de apareamiento, reconocen los cantos, la dieta, la distribución, etc. Pero al mismo tiempo, haciendo un uso absolutamente excepcional de las técnicas moleculares, se han puesto a ver la manera en que esos cambios evolutivos, esos cambios que van a las distintas poblaciones de las aves, de los pinzones en las Islas Galápagos, se pueden asociar con cambios primero en genes y luego en genomas y últimamente, como vamos a ver, en el microbioma de las aves. De manera que es un privilegio absoluto para el Colegio Nacional tener dos invitados tan queridos, tan especiales, y la conferencia va a funcionar de la siguiente manera. Primero el doctor Peter Grant va a hablar, y luego en un acto de coordinación académica extraordinaria, que estoy seguro que todos vamos a disfrutar, va a hablar la doctora Rosemary Grant, y luego al final vamos a tener preguntas, una sesión como de costumbre de preguntas, comentarios, etcétera. So, Rosemary, Peter, you are most welcome. It's an extraordinary pleasure, both on personal and academic perspectives, to have you here. And you're most welcome, not only by the Colegio Nacional, but also by all the people that are quite happy to be here today, this evening with you too. Thank you so much. Peter?
Well, thank you, Antonio, very much for that lovely introduction and also for the invitation here. It's been a great pleasure and a privilege to be here in order to give a lecture on the subject that you see up on the screen. Our subject is basically the biodiversity of the planet, and we can't study all of it. Biodiversity, people use the term biodiversity to refer to the extraordinary number of species on this planet. Millions, literally millions of species, and also their extraordinary variety in color, in shape, in complexity, and in size, in scale from the micro to the macro. And the problem for us evolutionary biologists, and it is one of the greatest challenges I think that evolutionary biologists face, is to explain this enormous variation, this enormous richness that we have. There's another problem as well, and that is to explain the maintenance of biodiversity. The lecture doesn't give us enough time to give adequate treatment to both of those questions, the explanation of biodiversity and the maintenance of biodiversity. So we're going to concentrate on the first one, the explanation for biodiversity, scaling down from the whole breadth of biodiversity to the essential evolutionary processes that have given rise to it. There is no simple explanation for why the world is so rich in biodiversity. Instead, our understanding is gradually improving as a result of an enormous range of research activity across a broad spectrum of the biological sciences, from the molecular biology, molecular genetics and genomics at one end of the spectrum, all the way through to paleontology and to biogeography at the other. Now, I'm going to show on the screen as the first slide a list of the sort of questions that we need to address in order to be able to advance our understanding of biodiversity, the how, the why, the when of biodiversity generation. And the list involves answering questions about history, what happened in the past, the environment, how that has changed, the traits of organisms that we see, photosynthesis, teeth, and so forth, and then the vast number of factors at the genetic and genomic level that are responsible for the traits. Well, now, adaptive radiations are very suitable groups of organisms to answer those questions. Adaptive radiations are groups of organisms that have diversified relatively recently and rapidly from a single ancestor. There are some outstanding examples, well known in the textbooks of introductory biology. One is the cichlid fish of the Great Lakes of Africa, hundreds of species in one lake, all derived from one or a very small number of ancestors. In the Caribbean, we have Anolis lizards, 150 species, all in that one archipelago. In Hawaii, there has been a radiation of plants in the Silver Sword Alliance. And in the same archipelago, there has been an outstanding radiation of honey creepers. Now, these are very suitable for us because they give us the opportunity to establish the transitions between one species and another, because the differences between species are relatively small, genomically as well as phenotypically, and they've done that in a relatively short space of time. So not only that, but adaptive radiations are suitable for exploring contemporary evolution, that is, evolution in organisms that are living today, under conditions of scientific rigor, which enables us to find causes of evolutionary diversification, which we can then apply to the history of phylogeny, that is, the evolutionary history of species in these clusters of highly diverse species. Our chosen group is not as dramatic in appearance as any of those. It's the group of 18 species, as currently recognized, of Darwin's finches in the Galapagos Archipelago. There are several advantages for studying them. Now, they all evolved in approximately 1 to 2 million years, so a relatively recent radiation, when they live in a very dynamic environment. The islands owe their origin, they're volcanic, they owe their origin to a hot spot that currently is southeast of Fernandina. And what you have to think of is all of the Galapagos are on a plate, the Nazca geophysical plate, that is heading towards the South American mainland at the rate of 60 kilometers per million years. Now, during the past million years, the sea level has risen and fallen as a result of glacial, interglacial cycles, 10 of them in the last million years. So with the result that islands, and here you see a modern depiction of the islands and their bathymetry, the islands appear from the air to grow in size and shrink in size. You don't see the increase in elevation, but that also has happened, and then the decrease. And the expansion of islands in some cases towards each other, even to the point of fusion, and then putting that into reverse when, during the interglacial times, the sea level rises, we get to the point where we are at today. So within this very dynamic environment, 18 species have evolved in the last billion years or so. And the question is, how did it happen? And can we throw light on the evolutionary processes that gave rise to it? Well, our ideas about this go back to Darwin. The key process is speciation. That is the process of divergence of two lineages from a single ancestral stock to the point at which eventually the two descendant lineages are no longer capable of interbreeding. And Darwin's contribution at the beginning was to put great emphasis upon spatial separation of these lineages in the early stages of divergence as a process that would facilitate speciation. And I'm going to put his ideas into modern language in a hypothetical example using the Galapagos and the essential ingredients of Darwin's ideas, which we live with today, are as follows. First of all, a component of dispersal from the mainland to the archipelago itself, the theater of evolution, and then dispersal from one island to the other until eventually, somewhere in the archipelago, the derived form and an original form come together to form coexistence, sympatry, the sharing of a single island environment. The processes giving rise to the divergence through time are, first of all, random genetic drift, the natural process of divergence through random processes in separate populations. And secondly, adaptation by natural selection, because the island environments are not identical. They constitute different selective pressures upon the organisms that live in them. And then finally, the coming together of two species or two populations are very closely related to this point here, hypothetically there, also can give rise to a further divergence by natural selection that minimizes two things. One is competition for basic resources, food principally, and the other one is interbreeding if the products of interbreeding are relatively unfit. That process of divergence is sometimes referred to as character displacement, and I'm going to give an example later on this little island of Daphne, so small it doesn't get a label on this diagram. But there it is. 40 years ago, no, more than 40, 45 years ago, we began a study of evolution on this island, which is 3/4 of a kilometer long and 120 meters high. And by sparseness and vegetation, you won't be surprised to learn that it has not been settled ever or contaminated by, in a permanent destructive way, by human habitation. It's occupied by four species in the groundfinch genus Geospiza, a small, a medium, and a large species, and one with a relatively pointed beak on the bottom right. Now I'm going to interrupt the scientific narrative to give you a brief glimpse of what it is like for scientists to be working on the island. It has a volcanic center, and the birds are everywhere, so we go everywhere ourselves. We live in a tent, we cook in a cave, we put up nets and capture the birds, take them out, and then transfer them to a cave where in the coolness of the shade, we're able to band them, measure them, weigh them, and then before they're released, a small drop of blood is taken from the brachial vein for transport back to North America for DNA analysis. Now, back to the four species. There are all of these dots refer to the average position of one species throughout the archipelago, several populations of this one, on a beak width, beak length plot. So there's a small, a medium, a large species, and one with a relatively pointed beak. These are, and I'm afraid I'm going to be using these names as well later, the medium ground finch is Fortis, and the cactus finch is Scandens. These are the principal species that we have been studying. The Fortis population on Daphne here has a population size of approximately 100 breeding pairs on average, and Scandon has a breeding population size of about half that amount. Gives you an idea of the scale of the populations we work with. Fortis, the medium ground finch, is a granivore and eats seeds, a little bit like a sparrow. Now, having banded and measured and released and observed literally hundreds of individuals of known measurements, we know by watching their feeding behavior carefully that those observed feeding only on small seeds have relatively small beaks, and those feeding on small, medium, and large seeds have large beaks. So the species is a generalist, but to some extent, there's individual specialization. Scandens, on the other hand, the cactus finch, is a specialist on cactus products. It probes into cactus flowers for nectar and for pollen, which is actually rich enough in protein for them to be able to raise offspring on that alone, although they do feed on a lot of other things. They also, with their long thin beaks, hammer holes in the side of a fruit, as shown up here, extract the seeds, and then crack them open in order to get the kernels on the inside. Now, the reason for thinking that these species are currently evolving is that they occur at the tip of a phylogeny which represents their evolutionary history from a common ancestor here. They're down here in the blue zone. They're at the tips of the phylogenetic tree. Not only that, but if we examine a plot of the number of lineages or species through elapsed time, starting from a time of when they once had a common ancestor, we see that the most recently evolved ones are increasing in frequency at a higher rate than ever before. So it does not look as if evolution, accumulation of species anyway, has come to a stop. So are they evolving now? And if so, how are they evolving? Why are they evolving? And what does that tell us about speciation? Well, they certainly are evolving. I'm showing here on this plot a 40-year span of time for the average beak depth of Fortis, the medium ground finch. And you'll notice three periods of main perturbation from a long-term average. One in 1977, one in the mid-80s, and one in the early 2000s. I'm going to be talking about each one of those three separately because they have, although they share a common denominator, which I'll now describe, the circumstances were different in each case. All of them involved a drought, a lack of production of seeds, heavy mortality, and a shrinkage in population numbers. So the first one occurred in 1977, and as you'll see from this graph of beak depth against date, average beak size increased during a period in which 85% of the medium ground finch, Fortis, died. And they died through starvation, and the mortality was size selective, size differential, because after the small seeds had been depleted in abundance, because they're the easy ones to pick up, birds had to turn increasingly to large and hard seeds, as illustrated with this little icon up here of a plant called tribulus that produces a woody fruit that is very difficult to crack. And only the birds with large beaks are able to crack those and extract the seeds. They survived, and the small birds did not, with the result of a net increase in average beak size of the population. So natural selection had occurred. Now, evolution occurs, and that is a change in genetic composition from one generation to the next as a result of selection, if the trait that's being selected is inherited, it is heritable. That is, if there's a genetic basis to the variation in the trait. And there certainly is, as you can see in this diagram, in which average parental size on a beak size plot predicts very strongly the average of the offspring size. The traits in question are beak depth and beak length, and the species are Fortis and Scandens. The slope of that relationship is a measure of the heritability of the trait, and it's high. On a scale of 0 to 1, 0.81 is high. It's about comparable to the heritability of human height, the height of us humans. So there's a large potential for evolution because there is a high degree of genetic variation underlying the trait. And so, not surprisingly, there was a strong evolutionary response to the selection in 1977, as indicated by the position of the average offspring beak size from produced by the survivors of the drought. So evolution had occurred as a result of natural selection on a heritably varying trait for mechanistic reasons that we could understand when the environment changed. The second episode involved something quite different, El Niño. El Niño is the phenomenon that in the eastern Pacific gives rise to an enormous amount of rainfall. 8 months of rainfall on that little island of Daphne, when usually the island will receive rain over 1 or 2 months only. This is the year, 1983, and notice before I move on, almost nothing 2 years later. So I'm going to display what happened in pictures. And the main story theme line here is that the enormous amount of rain affected the vegetation in such a way as to alter the seed size composition from a composition dominated by large and hard seeds to one dominated by small, soft seeds. Now, that is what Daphne looks like when the rains come in a typical season. And in the foreground is Tribulus, a prostrate plant close to the ground that produces the seeds that made a difference between survival and non-survival in 1977. But that is what the island looked like after a couple of months of heavy rain in the El Niño of 83. So you'll see lots of grasses growing up, but also vines. Vines growing up over the plants on the ground, but also growing up over the bushes and over the trees. And then, as the rains finished, the food supply dominated by small seeds was depleted during the ensuing couple of years, and including that drought. When times became tough for the finches to find enough food, it was the small birds with small beaks, particularly those with pointed beaks, capable of picking up very small packets of energy, small seeds, and processing them rapidly to maintain their energy needs, that had the selective advantage. So the pendulum swung towards a lower average beak size in the population. That was the second episode of evolution. The third one occurred once again for a very different set of reasons. Magnerostris, the large ground finch, had not been a resident member of the community of finches prior to that 1983 El Niño, but in that Niño year, two females and three males established a breeding population, and they bred, and they produced offspring, and very gradually, over the next 20 years, the numbers built up, so by the time the next serious drought arose in 2004, there were more than 150 individuals of this one on the island. Now, I think you can see just by looking at the massive beaks that they have, and imagine what the massive muscles are that operate those beaks, that they are very efficient, tribulus crackers. So what happened was they outcompeted the large members of the Fortis population, here's the Magnerostris, when the birds had to turn to these seeds because of a depletion of the food supply. Now, the small birds were also dying, but these worms outcompeted for the seeds that they were really good at cracking. Those ones died at a differentially higher rate. And so the average beak size went down as a result of the competitive influence of Magnerostris on the Fortis population. Here is a very steep decline, and it's an example of character displacement, that is the enhancement of the difference between Fortis on the one hand, becoming smaller, and Magna Rostris, that I mentioned as an example of character displacement up here, right at the beginning of the talk. Well, we know and understand a lot about this part of a diagram that links genotypic to phenotypic variation and the fitness consequences of that variation under the conditions of a changing environment. We know this part well and understand it well. But what about this part here? What about the genetic variation that underlies the phenotypic variation? We have answers to that as a result of two collaborations. One with developmental geneticists at Harvard, Cliff Tabin and Arkad Adjanov, have done studies that have identified signaling molecules that vary in relation to phenotype, beak phenotype. The first discovery was that bone morphogenetic protein 4, BMP4, is differentially expressed in the large Magna Rostris and smaller ones, all the way, if you can imagine a sequence of six species, all the way down to the smallest one, that is smallest in beak depth, from here to there, and a parallel range of diminished expression of BMP4. And transgenic experiments demonstrated this is not just a correlation, but it was in fact a causal relationship between genotype and phenotype. After that, they went on to discover calmodulin, a second signaling molecule, different pathway, affecting beak length. So beak depth all this way, beak length here, that leaves one further dimension, beak width, and that is governed by a regulatory pathway of signaling molecules later in development as cartilage is being condensed into bone. All of which raised the question, what about gene transcription? How are the genes actually operated? And here we have benefited very considerably from current ongoing collaboration with Leif Andersson, a molecular geneticist and a biochemist from the University of Uppsala in Sweden. They have discovered two transcription factors affecting beak shape and beak size. The first, ALX1, affects beak shape. The second one, HMGA2, affects beak size. And I'm going to describe in simple ways how they found one of them, HMGA2, and it goes as follows. They first of all did a complete genome sequencing operation on all of the 18 species and actually several individuals and several populations of each of the species. So with the genomes characterized, they then grouped the species into size classes, large and medium, medium and small, large and small, and made comparisons with the aligned genomes in those pairs, two groups at a time. And this is what they found, looking for the points along the genome sequences paired up, in this case, between large and small groups of birds, for that region where the two being compared differ most of all. And they found that there's one region common to all of these pairwise comparisons that has four genes stand out, one of which, HMGA2, is known to affect size regulation in mice, in dogs, in rabbits, and in us humans. Now, in Darwin's finches, HMGA2 variation is interestingly associated with phenotypic variation. So one variant has, on average, very large beaks. This is an indication of beak size. Another variant is associated with small beaks, and the intermediates are associated with intermediate size. And the really interesting thing is that in the character displacement event that I described, fitness was related to genotype as well as phenotype. And you can see this by comparing the left and the right columns. Here are the three genotypes, and here's their survival. The LL, large genotype, has very low survival. The SS, small genotype, has very high survival, and the intermediates, once again, the heterozygotes have intermediate fitness. In fact, the selection coefficient against the all allele was a remarkable 0.6. For those who might know what selection coefficient magnitudes mean, that is very, very large. Normally, if you can demonstrate a selection strength of about 0.05, you think that you've accomplished something quite remarkable. So 0.6 is very, very large. I'm now going to draw this part of the talk to an end with two conclusions. Natural selection occurs when the environment changes. Other species determine the direction of evolution, up or down in our case, because we're dealing with size. And these two are core ingredients of basic Darwinian ideas about natural selection starting in allopatry, being completed often in sympatry. And I want to leave you with the last image of the actual trajectory that I have been describing, which is not a single straight line from the beginning to the end, but rather undergoes a rather erratic trajectory depending upon environmental conditions varying at different times. So we started at this point here. As a result of natural selection, the population was shifted upscale. The second mid-80s selection event resulted in an allometric shift. Then at about that time, Magnaeostris up here, not shown, but up here came in. And the next selection episode resulted in the population being propelled down to a new position. And I'm not saying to a new species. What I am saying is that that trajectory, that way, is in the direction of a new species. It would have to go much further before we would claim that a new species had been formed. So this reveals the process of establishing ecological, morphological, and ecological differences between Magnaeostris up here and other species down here, and the enhancement of that ecological difference associated with morphological difference. But how did the species keep apart reproductively? At this point, I'm going to hand over to Rosemary.
So I'm going to take over and ask what are the causes and evolutionary consequences of rare gene flow between species, and I'm also going to tell you about one of the most exciting things that we have found in our study, and that is the origin of a new lineage which we have followed from its inception up through six generations. But to understand the first, I'm just going to go back to this Y diagram that Peter told you about. And to understand this, if you can imagine, as Peter said, if a population splits into two, goes into two different islands, different environmental conditions, then it will gradually diverge through the process of natural selection and evolutionary responses to natural selection, as Peter has shown you. The lineages will gradually become diagnosably different, and then this will continue until they get to the point when the lineages cannot interbreed at all for reasons of genetic incompatibility. Now, this in birds and in reptiles and in fish can take as long as, on average, 32 million years. In mammals, it's an order of magnitude less, but Darwin's finches' radiation has only been between 1 and 2 million years, so they lie about here, where the lineages become diagnosably different, and they would be kept apart by pre-mating barriers. So first of all, we should ask, why are they being kept apart, and what are the pre-mating barriers to reproduction between the species? And why does this barrier occasionally leak, which it does? So all Darwin's ground finches are similar in plumage. Males are black, females are brown and streaked. They all build similar nests, like these domed nests. And they all have, as far as we can tell, similar courtship display. But they do differ, as Peter has shown you, in morphology, that is in shape, and particularly in size and beak shape, and they also differ in song. And it turns out that song is very important. But first, we recognize the birds this way, but we first had to ask, well, can individual birds discriminate between their own and another species on the basis of morphology, appearance, in the absence of song? And then can they discriminate between their own and another species by song alone in the absence of morphology? And so to do the first, what we did is we took museum specimens. We put a female fortus on one end of a branch, a female scandens on another end of a branch, and we took this into a territory and asked, could the living territory owner discriminate between its own and another species, even though the females were stuffed museum specimens? And the answer was a resounding yes. They vigorously courted a female of their own species and completely ignored the other one, even though she was just a stuffed museum specimen. And we did this many times to many territories, and we also did it with controls. And then we asked, can they discriminate between their own and another species on the basis of song in the absence of any morphological cues? And to do this, we recorded song, playback song. When we played back Scandens song, Scandens came into the loudspeaker, Fortus completely ignored it. When we played back Fortus song, Fortus came in, Scandens completely ignored it. So clearly, just as we could tell the difference between the species on appearance and song, so could the individual birds. The song is very different between the individuals. Fortus song has this modulated song, and Scandens a series of repeated notes. There's individual variation between the songs of the species within the species, but always on a species-specific song theme. So there's a little bit of variation in this, but always recognizably Fortus. Also a little bit of variation there, but again, always recognizably Scandens. The song we know from work done by Bowman in the 1950s, when he was able to take captive birds and do experiments with these captive birds, he was able to show that song is learnt from the father in association with his appearance during a short, very receptive period early in life between day 10 and day 40. Now, in the wild, this corresponds to the last few days when the birds are in the nest and when they're out of the nest being fed by their parents, and all this time the male is singing. So it's not too surprising that the birds in the nest learn perfect renderings of their father's song. The females don't sing. Once learnt, the song is retained for life, and we know this by recording the songs every year, and life can be as long as 17 years. When they're adult, they pair according to their species song, learnt early in life, in association with their morphology. So this constitutes a pre-mating barrier to interbreeding. It's based on song, which is learnt and culturally transmitted from father to son, and also morphology, particularly beak and body size, which Peter has shown you is genetically transmitted. But we can ask, how robust is this barrier? Because after all, it is based on learning. And it is very vulnerable to disruption if a young bird hears and learns a song of another species during its short sensitive period. And this does happen, and it happens in this way. If the male dies and the female is left to rear the offspring, and the female doesn't sing, then the young in the nest, and when they're out of the nest, they hear a male from the natal territory. And if that male is a male of another species, then it will learn that species' song. And this happens rarely, but it happens consistently, about 1% in every breeding season. So we can ask, well, what happens to these birds? Now, the colonization of Magnarostris that Peter told you about gave us a chance to test this. Now, Magnarostris is a very large bird. It's 32 grams, almost twice the size of Fortus, of 17 grams, and it's also extremely aggressive. Now, nevertheless, we had 8 Fortus and 2 Scandens that learnt and sang a Magnarostris song. So this is a Magnarostris song down here, a typical Fortus song here. This is one of the Fortus that sang the Magnarostris song. typical Scandin song here, and one of the Scandins sang a Magna Rostris song. But none of these bred with Magna Rostris. And the reason was that when these little birds grew up and they sang a Magna Rostris song, a Magna Rostris came in from nowhere and just beat them up. So nothing happened. They never got anywhere. But so when the size difference is very large, the barrier appears to be robust. Even learning another species song didn't lead to hybridization. But when the size difference is small, as it is between Scandins and Fortis, learning another species song can lead to hybridization. And this also happens consistently about 1 or 2% of the every breeding season. So we had this group of Fortis Scandins hybrids which we could follow. And at first we were very excited. We thought, oh, well, maybe we'll be seeing the very beginnings of genetic incompatibility between the two. But we followed these hybrids and we found that in the first 10 years of our study, none of them survived to breed. And the reason is we thought either it was genetic incompatibility or that maybe there wasn't the appropriate seeds that were available for birds of intermediate beak sizes. Because for these first 10 years of the study in the dry season, the dry season was extremely severe. Most of the seeds were these large hard tribulus seeds and also Scandin seeds. We watched the hybrids and we found that they couldn't feed on the large hard tribulus seeds. They could feed on the Opuntia seeds, but they took three times longer to do so than Scandins. And this is probably why that we weren't finding any, because there weren't very many of them. None of them were being surviving. However, after the El Nino event, when the island was changed from a large hard seed producer to a small soft seed producer, then these hybrids began to survive. And they backcrossed, they didn't breed with each other, but they backcrossed according to the song that they had learnt. So we had a trickle of genes flowing from Scandins into Fortis and from Fortis into Scandins. And these hybrids did extremely well, continued to breed according to the song type. And we had, at this point, we had blood samples and we had microsatellite loci. So we were able to track the genes going from Scandin into Fortis and Fortis into Scandins. And we could see that they both began to converge genetically from this point onwards when they began to hybridize and interbreed. We saw that the genes converged across the years and continued to do so. And but from our measurements of all the birds, the morphological measurements showed that this was absolutely in parallel. So they converged genetically and morphologically, and the average beak shape of Scandins became blunter from this point onwards and more Fortis-like, and the average beak shape of Fortis from this point onwards became more pointed and more Scandins-like. But now that we're collaborating with Leif Anderson and his group in Uppsala, we're able to take our blood samples, which we had stored in a minus 20 freezer, and we're able to go back, and we're now able to ask, were there any specific alleles that could have contributed to this change in beaks? And they did exactly the same sort of thing that Peter told you about. They took all the these species now, all the sharp-billed species and all the blunt-billed species, and compared them. And they found a gene that encodes a transcription factor in a 240 kilobase region. And one of these genes was a very exciting one because it was ALX1. And we knew that ALX1 is involved in craniofacial development in things like mammals and fish, and even in ourselves, a mutation at the ALX1 region causes cleft palate in humans. But in our finches, it comes in two alleles. The homozygous blunt allele is associated with those species with blunt beaks, and then homozygous for the pointed allele is associated with species with pointed beaks, but Fortison scandens had both alleles in the population. So this was very exciting to us. So we again went back into our freezer and we got 62 blood samples from this time, where we knew the measurements of the birds. We knew whether they had pointed blunt beaks or pointed beaks, and this was in the Fortis population. And we sent them blind over to Uppsala, to Sweden. And the results came back that the homozygous blunt were the blunt beak birds, homozygous pointed beak birds, and the heterozygotes were in between. Now, we're still working on this just to find out exactly what is happening at this point in the genome. So also we looked at the hybrids and we found that the ALX1 pointed allele had a frequency of 0.75 in the hybrids and 0.44 in the Fortis non-hybrids, which suggests that it confirms that the ALX1 pointed was going from moving from scandens into Fortis and causing Fortis beaks to become more pointed. And these more pointed beaks we were able to show were much better adapted at exploiting the small soft seeds that were now very plentiful in the environment. So we could see that both the genetic and morphological variation had increased, and we argued that this mosaic genome arising from hybridization between two species generates phenotypic novelties that would be under selection in a new environment if it had gone to a new island with completely different ecological conditions. We said that this increased genetic and phenotypic variation could fuel a rapid change along a different trajectory. Well, this is what we argued might happen, and we never thought that it would. But then we were actually to see that, very excitingly, that this is exactly what happened. And it happened in this way in the formation of this new lineage. A bird arrived on the island at the time when we had all birds on the island banded. And it looked like a Fortis, but it was huge. When we caught it and weighed it, it weighed 28.5 grams. A Fortis is a 17-gram bird. And you can imagine it looked like a giant. When it began to sing, it had a completely unique song, unlike any song that we'd actually heard anywhere in the archipelago. And we had matched it up with, this time we were again using microsatellites. We matched its genome profile up with all the birds on the island. It didn't match, it obviously had not been born on the island. And what we did is we looked at all the birds, blood samples from the birds that we'd taken on the islands around Daphne. And at that point, we found that it matched a Fortis scandens Fortis back cross from the biggest island of Santa Cruz, the nearest neighboring island of Santa Cruz. And we actually published this data. But we were wrong, because with the full genome analysis that we have just recently done, now that we have the whole genomes of all the Darwin's finches from our blood samples, we found that it was actually a Conirostris that had come all the way from Espanola and must have arrived on Daphne. Now, Peter and I went back to our notebooks, and we found that we'd both written in the notebooks that this weird bird looked like a Conirostris that came from Espanola, but we couldn't believe this because it was so far away. And but actually, this is what it turned out to be. Now, this bird took a long time to breed. It finally bred with a Fortis, a female Fortis, at the very end of a breeding season, and this female Fortis had lost its mate. And this bird, 511, we banded it 5110. 5110 had a very nice territory, and it paired up with this Fortis. And then he paired up with another Fortis. So we followed all the offspring, took blood samples from them, measured them. They were all large. They all showed genetic transmission from 5110, and they all sang 5110's song. And then along came the 2.5-year drought that Peter told you about, when 90% of all birds on the island died, and all these birds went out, but two were left, a brother, an inbred brother and sister. So 2.5 years later, when the rains came back, the brother and sister bred with each other. They produced 26 offspring. All but 9 survived. We had a daughter breeding with a father, a son breeding with his mother, and the rest of the sibs breeding with each other to produce more sibs, to produce breeding with each other to produce more sibs. We caught all these births, took blood samples from them. They all showed genetic transmission from 5110. All males sang 5110's song, and all were large like 5110. So this new lineage, and they all showed, now with, we have the genome, we all have full genome analysis of all these births, and we see that they, just as we would expect, they become progressively inbred as we go up the generations. But actually, the inbreeding coefficient is only at 0.6 now, which is not extremely high. So they are very inbred and definitely inbred, but they still, because they started with so much genetic variation from two different species, they are still not so incredibly inbred. And we're seeing no signs of inbreeding problems arising. The other thing that is extremely interesting is that this new group of birds, which is in blue, and we call it the big bird group, has shown an allometric shift. It doesn't lie between Conirostris and Fortis. It doesn't lie in this space, but it's shifted up. So it has a relatively large bill on a smaller body. It feeds on everything that all the birds does. It feeds on cactus, it feeds on big seeds, it feeds on small seeds. But it's extremely efficient on these large, hard, tribulus seeds, which has made the difference between survival and non-survival in the last droughts. And it's just as efficient as Magnirostris at cracking these tribulus seeds, but being smaller in body size, it requires less of them to get through to survive. So if there is another drought with the same sorts of tribulus, with the same sorts of hard seeds surviving, the tribulus seeds surviving, it's likely to do very well. So the new lineage is behaving like a separate species. It's much larger than Fortis, its nearest ancestor. In morphological space, with beak length over beak depth, it lies between Magnirostris in green and Fortis in blue, right here in this purple big bird group. And this is the gap that expanded during the character displacement that Peter told you about when Magnirostris outcompeted the largest Fortis, which were up here, and the big birds moved right in. It differs in song. This is three generations of the big bird song, very different from Fortis songs, Scandin songs, and Magnirostris songs. It breeds in just one part of the island. The blue dots are the territories before the drought, the red dots after the drought, and there are a few more over the cliff. And the pairs hold contiguous territories, which they defend against each other. These territories overlap with the territories of Fortis, Scandins, and Magnirostris, whom they ignore and are ignored by them. So in all respects, this lineage is functioning as a separate species. Will it die out through inbreeding depression? It could, but so far it's pretty vigorous. Will the genetic variation be augmented through gene exchange, just as we got hybrids between Fortis and Scandins? Once again, it could. And we thought that this was really quite possibly, maybe even with Magnirostris, which is nearer to it in size. But we have not seen any sign of this, and we've really looked for it. But whether it survives or not, this new lineage gives us insight into how a new species could arise and either persist or become extinct. So in summary, when we went in 1973, at the beginning, we had two very distinct populations, Fortis and Scandins, on this beak depth, beak length plot. And it was not until 10 years later, after the 1983 El Nino, that we got hybrids between Fortis and Scandins surviving, and we got these two populations fusing and beginning to merge. Magnirostris came in at this point, and the big bird, which I just told you about, moved into this gap. So we left in after 2012 with a very different set of birds on the island. So this has given us insights into two models of speciation, the Darwin model, which is called now called the allopatric speciation model that Peter told you about, where there was no interbreeding on secondary contact between Magnanostris and Fortus, and we got this character displacement event which led to this morphological divergence. And then we have what I have just told you about with hybridization introgression, which is now called homoploid hybrid speciation, where we found that hybridization in a new environment led to the development of a new and very unique lineage of a big bird lineage. So this introgressive hybridization as a source of variation for adaptation to new environments was discussed quite extensively by both Dobzhansky and then Lewontin and Birch had two very nice field studies showing that this happened in a fruit fly, the Dacus fruit fly in Australia. But then it was forgotten completely and thought not to be important in animals, although it was always known to be important in plants. But since in the last, in fact, when we first started to try and publish these results, we were just told, well, this couldn't have happened because this didn't happen in things like birds. But we now know where the environment has really completely changed as far as this goes. We now know from Svante Paabo's work and all his colleagues that we have immune alleles from Neanderthals that are going into modern humans, which facilitate their adaptation to non-African environments. We know that this introgression or hybridization is important in wing pattern mimicry in butterflies, and we've seen it in mice, insecticide resistance, and in the many, many examples now. Almost every time you open a journal, you're seeing an example of this sort of thing happening. It's also, to us, very exciting to know that we have done pure science and it's having an effect on humans. We've been invited both to the British Research, a Cancer Research Center in London, and also in Texas, to discuss the results of our works with cancer evolution. Because if you think of it, cancer clone evolution takes place within tissue ecosystems in a very similar way to the sorts of things we've just told you about in Darwin's finches. A cancer clone in the colon is going to be very different, have a very different environment from a cancer clone in the lung, let's say. And also quite excitingly, we also know that there's horizontal gene transfer, which is having an effect on this, and this is looking for the sorts of ways that we could possibly target the cancer to try and cause a cure for cancer. And there's a very interesting paper last year where the tumor suppressor ABC gene function was destroyed due to rearrangements associated with an introgressed retrotransposon through horizontal gene transfer. So we thank our many graduates, postdoctoral fellows, our collaborators. None of this could be done without them, and also our logistical support and our financial support. But anybody, I think, who's worked on these islands would want to leave you, as I'm going to do right now, with two messages. First of it is we live in very exciting times. And the young people in this audience, as I know there are many, who are really living in an exciting time. The genomic data is rapidly accumulating. It's becoming much cheaper to be able to do this. And this can enhance our studies enormously. But reciprocally, I think it's important to remember that a reliable interpretation of genetic data requires an understanding of ecology, evolution, and behavior in nature. The other message I think that we can take from our work is one about biodiversity. Charles Darwin ends his Origin of Species with these magical words. While this planet has gone cycling on according to fixed laws of gravity from so simple a beginning, endless forms, most beautiful and most wonderful, have been and are being evolved. But we know, unfortunately, that the global biodiversity has been degraded at an unprecedented rate. We see this whether we're hiking in the alpine meadows, whether we're exploring the tropical rainforests, or whether we're diving beneath the surface of the sea. So we know that environments and populations are dynamic. We've just given you an example of this, and they're constantly changing. And to maintain biodiversity and the potential for future speciation, we must keep them both, environments and populations, capable of further natural change. Thank you.
Rosemary, Peter, thank you so much for this wonderful lecture. Tenemos tiempo para preguntas, comentarios, después de una charla verdaderamente excepcional que con mucho superó, estoy seguro, las expectativas que todos teníamos al respecto. Don Omar, sí.
Me da la impresión de que, a pesar de que siempre nos muestran ejemplos contundentes de que procesos de hibridación o procesos de cambio ecológico, ambientales, generan nuevas especies, me da la impresión de que pareciera que la evolución queda detenida en los libros. Cuando uno intenta publicar resultados de este tipo, cuesta mucho trabajo convencer a los revisores de que efectivamente eso está ocurriendo. Entonces, no sé si es una tendencia normal o algo pasa que no es tan fácil convencer a los biólogos evolucionistas de que esto efectivamente está ocurriendo.
I'm sorry, I didn't completely follow all of it, but now I do. Now I understand. That's true, and I think we just have to continue publishing and being as careful as we can to show that the way we do our results show that we actually we've got to be very careful when we publish our results to show that they're actually absolutely secure. Yeah.
Había Don Omar.
Gracias. Gracias, doctor. Thank you very much. Congratulations. It was a very fascinating talk. I enjoyed it a lot. And it seems like we have to preserve islands all over the world. We have to emphasize the need for protections because, as you can see, there is a lot of speciation at any time on islands. And our question is, how do the species keep their identities when we have these different mechanisms for, the origin of new species?
Yes, sometimes I think not only do we have to, this is happening just in islands make it easy to study this, but it's also happening on the continent as well. And so I can give a very nice example from Lauren Riesberg's work. And when you say, how do the species keep their identity? He's been able to show this in sunflowers, exactly the same sort of things that we have shown. And so for the sunflowers, they keep their identity, if you like, because they actually land on different ecological positions. So there is a group of sunflowers that has arisen through hybridization that is now in salt marshes. And so they are all in salty areas. So they're kept there in the salty areas. And it's only in the edges that you get them hybridizing. With our birds, they are kept in groups by song, very much by song. And the song on each on each island is very different. Now, what is quite interesting is that, let's say, Porto Song on Daphne, well, Fortis will have a rather different song on the different islands. But if you take an island like Santa Cruz, which is huge, and there are 9 or 10 species of pinchers on there, but they all have very clearly distinct songs. And so they use song, and also they have distinct morphologies. There is still a little bit of hybridization, but they're kept in their groups through song. Yeah.
Sí, por favor.
Well, thank you very much for your talk. It was. Thank you very much for your talk. It was quite interesting, as always. And I was wondering, because if memory serves me right, I think you published in one of your books in the year 2000 something about another case of hybridization and maybe a new hybrid lineage coming to be. But then you mentioned in this book that it was basically reabsorbed into one of the parental species.
Yeah.
So I was wondering, are there any chances that the big bird lineage is going to be reabsorbed, or has it evolved any isolating mechanisms to so biologists can finally recognize it as different, or what are we going to do for the taxonomy of this group?
Yes, I should let Peter answer some of these.
I have to apologize that I don't hear very well. And I also have hearing aids, which magnifies not only your voice, but also the reverberation of your voice. And so I miss lots of words, and I rely upon Rosemary.
Okay, so I'll
but if I hear Rosemary tell me what the question was, I might be able to give an answer.
So, okay, I'll start, and then if Peter can finish. But yes, I mean, what is really exciting about this, and this is ongoing research at the moment with our Swedish colleagues. So we know what I've just told you about, but we also have full genome analysis of all these birds now. So what we are really very excited about finding out is actually what is happening now in the genome, which genes is obviously a mosaic that is of genes in the genome, which genes are getting through and which genes are not. And I think this big bird lineage that I just told you about, which is very different, so it will be very interesting to see what genes have got through, particularly from Fortis, which is living with right now, and which genes haven't. Are there inversions in certain areas where, which would suggest if this would continue, this would be the very beginning of genetic incompatibility or differences that might be maintained. Or we might see not. We might see it just disintegrating. So this is sort of ongoing research that we're doing right now at the moment, and we don't know what the result is. So,
do you want to add to it?
I was going to amplify just one remark that you made about looking at ongoing change and the genetic basis of it. Rosemary showed a diagram of an allometric shift, that is, the big bird lineage has a length to depth ratio or relationship different from the species that gave rise to it. And there's obviously a differential transfer of genes from the two species into this new lineage. The genomic basis of that is potentially fascinating. And we can't say anything more at the moment because we don't have any results, but a very obvious thing that we're going to be looking at is the possibility of mutation and inversions, chromosomal inversions, that might be somehow locking up genes in unusual combinations in the big bird lineage. That's speculation at the moment, and we'll have to see what happens. One other comment, I would also like to reinforce what Rosemary said about species on other in continental regions undergoing change. We know lots and lots of studies of mainly terrestrial organisms, but some marine organisms, which are undergoing evolutionary change. The rate at which they're undergoing change is typically slower than what we have seen in a very short period of time. 40 years is a short period of time. On Daphne. And so our conception of the process is that evolution is speeded up to the point of speciation, that is, to the point of the evolution of reproductive isolation, significant reproductive isolation, speeded up on islands relative to most mainland situations, but not all. And the reason for saying the not all is that some mainland environments are actually insular in character. Lakes are, for one thing, mountaintops are another. And to an extent that we do not understand, I think that within apparently homogeneous habitats like lowland tropical rainforests, there's probably a degree of heterogeneity, local neighborhoods of interbreeding individuals separated from others that we haven't been able to document because most studies do not go into that detail and certainly don't go into the detail for a long period of time. So in short, my answer is that yes, islands are different from mainlands, but maybe not as much due to our ignorance, maybe not as much as we think at the moment.
Don Omar, sí, por favor.
First of all, thank you for your talk. Your work is fascinating and very inspiring for us. My question is, have you documented changes in the singing patterns of the birds? I mean, I was wondering how new singing patterns emerge inside a one species.
So I think I've missed one word. How do
singing patterns emerge? I mean, the singing patterns are different between birds.
Oh, singing patterns in birds. Yes, sorry.
Thank you.
Sorry about this. How do I see the singing emergence of changes in song? What we didn't talk about today, we had one very, very interesting situation where when the Magnanostris came in, the Portus and Scandin songs shifted away from the Magnanostris songs. And we can, and I don't have a slide at the end that I could have shown, I mean, that I could show you this, but we've been able to document this shift away from Magnanostris. What actually happened was that it was almost as if Portus songs and Scandin songs became sort of compressed. And we were able to show that this wasn't happening after they had learned the song, but it must have been happening at the time of learning of song. So what we think probably the reason why we saw this happening at the time they were learning the song was that the Magnanostris was singing. It had built up its population quite a lot by then. It was actually a couple of hundred individuals on the island. And they were their song is very loud, it's very insistent. They seem to sing on top of other people, of other other people, of other species. And so what we think is that the young birds learning their father's song was learning, you know, it in sort of compressed bits. And so the song was almost becoming more compressed. So instead of getting the two or three in modulated parts in Portus, we were getting more like four or five, and it was being sung in a faster time, which was the whole thing was moving away. So that we've been able to see within an island, and I think this thing must have been going on within other islands as well, because we have this incredible situation where we see Portus and Scandin songs having very different songs on the different island, but in no one island are the songs overlapped in acoustical space. So that's the nearest I can get to this. I should also say that the females we know learn, even though they don't sing, they learn their father's song. And there are other species that do this. Actually, the zebra finch does that, and there are some other finch species that have the same sort of learning of song.
Mm-hmm. Sí, por favor.
Bueno, okay. Gracias por esta poesía del canto, porque eso es, ¿no? O sea, la poesía y el amor, ¿no? Pero yo quisiera invitarlos en el norte de Nayarit. Tenemos esteros, pero de muchos kilómetros, donde hay camarón, jaiba, pescados, y no ha sido estudiado toda esa zona. Ojalá pudieran conocer el norte de Nayarit, donde nos pegó un huracán, que apenas están rescatando a estos 190 mil damnificados.
It's just an
Yes, so that's exactly the sort of thing when somebody said this happened in continental, so the exactly the sort of thing that you see with the differences in marshlands, and especially with something like earthquakes or something that can happen like that. There's another lovely example of, and this is sticklebacks, where there was, I think it was with a tsunami or a different, or maybe a displacement of land, where suddenly the land, suddenly there was an uprising of land, that's what it was. So the sticklebacks were actually trapped, and very, very quickly you got a change in the going from a marine form into a freshwater form, and the limnetic and benthic forms happening extremely quickly.
Yeah. I can add to that. That's one thing I can add to.
Yes, it happened in Alaska, I think, in 1954, that there was this formation of an island with water on the inside accumulating through rain, becoming like a freshwater lake on the mainland of British Columbia and Alaska. And the change that Rosemary described over a period of 50 years was quite substantial at the genetic level and resulted in a considerable convergence on the freshwater forms of sticklebacks on the mainland. So it's like evolution speeded up on islands in that very short space of time. The difference between the marine stickleback and a freshwater stickleback has been investigated by David Kingsley's group, both Dolph Sluser's group at Stanford and UBC, respectively. And they've identified genes that control the regulation of traits like body armor and spines on the back, the stickles on the back of sticklebacks. So they're fundamental genes that confer adaptive properties on the organisms. And the remarkable thing is that what has been assumed to be a process of evolution taking place over perhaps thousands of years, going from marine to freshwater phenotypes as a result of the retreat of the ice age, the opening up of freshwater bodies on the mainland, and the invasion by marine sticklebacks, and then their evolutionary divergence, actually happened within 50 years on this little microcosm.
Dr. Sarukhan.
Yeah. Well, it is a privilege to have you in Mexico and in El Colegio Nacional, certainly. And thank you for this wonderful view into evolution in action. It was really wonderful. I was looking at the data that you both presented. It gives the impression that immigration is not playing a very important role, which is odd because the island is very small. It's very close to a much bigger island, and the species move from one place to another. If it is the case, what is precluding really stronger flux into other genetic sources or material from nearby islands?
Yes, we've wondered exactly the same thing. I mean, we've had this one bird that came all the way, somehow arrived. Within our 40 years' time, we've had how many Scandins? Two Scandins have arrived and stayed, and how many Fortis?
We've had two Fortis immigrants from other islands establishing breeding status. The others come in the dry season and feed, and so they have an ecological impact, but they go back to their island of origin, we think, and only two have stayed to breed that we know. Maybe there are one or two more that we missed, but two definitely, three Fortis and two Scandins. So, interested in what is the genetic influence of this conspecific gene exchange, we did a calculation of how quantitatively important that was relative to the exchange of genes between species, between Fortis and Scandens, and another part of the story we didn't tell you about, between Fortis and Phalaenopsis, the small ground finch, that is an occasional immigrant and will very rarely breed. So putting the heterospecific gene flow together with compared with the conspecific gene flow, we found something like a threefold difference between those two, with conspecific gene flow being very small and heterospecific gene exchange being very much larger. Quantitatively, but also, that is, numbers of genes going in, but also the effects of those genes. Put those two together, numbers and effects of the gene, and there's a big difference as a result of hybridization and introgression compared with conspecific gene exchange.
And just to add that, to that as well, I think one of the reasons why they don't stay to breed, but when they come over in the dry season sometimes to feed and then go, often quite quickly they will go, they have a different song environment. So I think they're not recognizing the songs of, I think song is quite important in keeping the distinction. And also the islands are extraordinarily different in ecology. I don't know if you've been to the Galapagos, but and you probably noticed that every island is very, very different in, yeah. So I think the combination of the behavior of the birds and what Peter was saying, but this is something that we, yes, as Peter says, that we have looked at, yeah. Yeah, thank you.
There's an additional final question for me,
yes.
Using the privilege of being the chair of the session.
Yeah, that's prerogative.
Yes. With this change of diet, this appearance of new species or this process of separation, mm-hmm. I cannot help wonder about the microbiota.
Oh, yes.
And on the one hand, and on the other hand, of ectoparasites.
Right, yes. So the microbiota, we've really encouraged two groups of people to look at that, and they're looking at it right now. And because I think that could be fascinating, because the same species on different islands, but also even within an individual, they change their diet very much from the dry season to the wet right. season, and so the microbiome must be changing along with that. And then the ectoparasites, now we have collected, they do have ectoparasites, we've collected those, we've sent them over for people to look at, and I don't know how much, and people have looked at this, how much the ectoparasites are really disturbing them. But not on Daphne, but on other islands that are much wetter, there are other parasites. There's a nest parasite called Phalaenus, and that actually is devastating to the mm-hmm. finches. There's also a pox that that comes over every now and again. And that on Daphne, we looked at that. It a lot of birds had pox, but when we looked at the survival of those birds with pox and those without, there was no significant difference. Mm. And I think this is partly because there aren't very many predators on. So when they get ill, they just go underneath cactus and manage to feed. The pox is usually in the breeding season. It affects their breeding. We do know that. But it doesn't seem to affect their survival. But I'm sure on another island with more predators, that when they get ill, they're probably picked off by predators. So there are these things that do go on. And I'm really curious about the microbiome.
Creo que estarán de acuerdo conmigo que esta es una manera espléndida de poner fin a los seminarios de los viernes de evolución correspondientes a este año.
Normalmente pensamos en diciembre como un mes de fiestas, y creo que hoy hemos tenido más que una fiesta, un banquete intelectual absolutamente espléndido. A nombre del Colegio Nacional, y en particular a nombre del doctor Sarucán, del mío propio, les queremos dar las gracias por su asistencia, pero sobre todo darles las gracias muy sinceras a la doctora Rosemary Grant y al doctor Peter Grant por haber estado con nosotros esta noche. Thank you. Y si me lo permiten, para que vayan programando sus agendas, formalmente comenzamos los viernes de la evolución en febrero, nunca he entendido por qué, tampoco tiene por qué ser una regla, y en enero, aprovechando la visita de un biólogo molecular extraordinariamente distinguido, el doctor Andreas Lupas, director de uno de los institutos Max Planck, que va a estar visitando unos colegas mexicanos en Ensenada, y lo vamos a tener a finales de enero. Va a hablar sobre evolución de proteínas y conservación evolutiva de pequeños motivos en las proteínas. Probablemente en enero también, ahí sí no les puedo dar la fecha precisa todavía, o tal vez en febrero, el doctor Loren Graham, que es uno de los grandes expertos en la historia de la ciencia y la tecnología en la Unión Soviética primero y en Rusia después, va a visitar México, y como él ha estudiado con mucho detalle el caso de Lysenko, y como el Lysenko fue un personaje infamous, se diría en inglés, que tuvo cierta cercanía intelectual con Oparin, probablemente vamos a tener una mesa redonda entre él y yo mismo, también como parte de los seminarios adicionales de los Viernes de Evolución. Dicho eso, creo que hemos roto la mejor piñata de la primer posada intelectual de diciembre. Muchas gracias y nos vemos el año próximo.
La gran arquitectura hace que de pronto nos detengamos a ver un edificio, a ver un espacio. Y yo creo que eso es lo que logra Teodoro González de León en sus edificios.
His buildings are often pedestrian precincts. in a city or cities which are heavily automobile.
Teodoro trabaja todo el tiempo unas hojitas de papel para hacer croquis, ¿no? Y prácticamente ahí están los proyectos. De repente puede dar un pedacito de este tamaño y ahí viene prácticamente todas las reglas de cómo trazar algo, ¿no?
Yo sí creo que la arquitectura, cuando te toca hacerla, tienes que marcar el punto ese, marcarlo. No yo, el edificio, que sea una marca urbana.